a friend of mine, she probably even didn't notice, but I told her that I bought a ring light, and she was like, "Ha, was serious? When I look at no work on TikTok."
Hectic.
I think at that moment she didn't
Of
notice.
course, of
Yeah,
course.
she didn't realize that what she was saying.
Hey family, a quick one. Over 87% of you are consuming this content every single week but are not subscribed. That means you are enjoying the growth conversations, but you are not liking, you are not subscribing, and you are not sharing it with others. So please, I plead with you, please subscribe so that you can share the love, you can share the growth, and you can share this wonderful platform and wonderful safe space with others as well. Enjoy the episode.
You live in Cape Town, you live in Durban, you live in Joburg. What's going on with your life, Tadeus?
I know.
Do you even know what's going on with your life?
I do.
Yeah.
I guess I'm here now permanently.
Yeah.
But I was in Cape Town because I studied there at
Sure.
UCT. So now I'm done. I grew up in Durban. Yeah. So now I'm done. Now I'm here to chase my dreams.
are they being chased properly though?
Yes.
We have one good. It's
yeah, it's coming together. It's manifesting.
Yeah.
It's manifesting. Beautifully so, also.
Beautifully so. Eh?
Yes.
You look great, by the way, as I was saying.
Oh,
You
thank
smell
you.
great too.
Thank
So
you.
people on camera can't smell you, but we can smell you, the team here.
Thank you.
And welcome to Engineer Your Life.
Thank you.
You've been crying a lot.
Really?
You have. Do you still believe in love?
Yeah, I do. I do.
Ne?
I do, yes, I do.
Did love hurt you?
Not really. I mean, maybe. I'm still new to it, let me say that.
Okay.
So it's a matter of figuring it out. So I think my friends say that it did hurt me.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Was it your first love?
Yes, it was.
Oh, no wonder. You'll be fine.
I will.
It's not that deep.
Hopefully.
First love.
Yeah. Hopefully. Hopefully I will. But I am doing quite great now.
What hurts about that first love?
I don't know. I guess dealing with somebody who hasn't dealt with their own things. And
okay.
And then you being the receiver of everything. And then you get to a point where you're like, I can't anymore.
Did you feel like things were done to you?
Yes.
A lot of things.
Yes.
And you have no part to play in the things that were done to you?
I mean, look, I guess with me, I always say that I'm not perfect. I wasn't perfect.
Sure.
Right? But the thing with me, I was always willing to listen, adapt, and grow, and take into consideration what you are essentially concerned about. So if, for instance, if we're on a video call, because I'm so used to being on a video call with my friends, able to like go on other apps and stuff, but with that one specifically, he didn't want me to.
Sure.
He wanted all the
undivided attention.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I listened to that, and I grew and adapted, and I made sure that it never happens again.
Yeah.
So it's things like that, you know. I was always willing to make sure that things never happen again, but I wasn't giving the same grace.
I hear you.
So all the time, I was made to seem as if, I'm the one that's wrong. So I'm feeling like this because, oh, you did 1, 2, 3.
What sort of things did you receive?
Like, I was always apologizing.
Sure.
Yeah, I was always made to apologize. Every single day there was something.
That you're right? Apologizing
yeah,
for?
Yeah, every single day was something. And whenever I had a concern, I would never be given grace.
Gaslit.
Gaslit, manipulation, and stuff like that. And it will always be turned against me. So
did they have more experience than you in dating?
Yes, yes.
That's a typical gaslighter.
Yeah.
Because they know which buttons to press to get things to go their way.
Yeah. It took me time to realize it. I'm
yeah.
not gonna lie. It took me time to realize it because I guess being new to all of this, I'm like, okay, maybe this is how it is. You know, it got to a point where I couldn't even speak about how I felt about certain things because I was like, okay, it's going to start something else. So I might as well just not even say anything at all. On top of me having to apologize every single day.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to have to apologize for feeling the way I feel also about certain things.
Looking back, what makes a person be so manipulative and a liar? Because I can even sense that there were a lot of lies in this. What makes a person like that? Because surely, as the one who's experienced in relationships, they should know that you must offer grace. They should know that you should be kind. That you should, when a person is being insecure as a partner, you should return that with even more love instead of highlighting their insecurities.
Yes.
What do you think makes a person do that towards another person that they claim to love?
I mean, I don't know. Maybe unhealed traumas.
Sure.
I don't know. I mean, there's various reasons. They may be, but the only thing I can think about right now is unhealed traumas from the past, I guess.
Yeah.
I think those are the things that...
Do you feel like you failed at that relationship?
I don't think I failed. I don't think I've, I think I tried my best. I think I tried my best with the little experience that I had. I think I really did try my best.
Was your best good enough though?
I think it was. I think circumstances just didn't allow it.
Especially from
the other party.
I love that you're saying that because sometimes we are told that your best doesn't mean it's the best. Right?
Yeah.
And it, you having the contentment that your best was the best for that situation means that you're on the road to healing. You can still cry. We know you'll still cry for us on TikTok. Things that hurt, hurt. And it's okay to be expressive, to go through the motions, to go through the pain. And but it, it makes you a better person.
It does.
Where are you in the healing journey right now, specifically for that relationship?
I mean, I guess... It's been 40 days. It's been 40 days without speaking. I guess it's been probably 2 months since the relationship ended. So I'm doing quite fine.
Yeah, I'm doing quite fine. Was it an amicable ending? Or did you were you like, no, this is enough. Enough is enough and I'm checking out of this.
Yeah, I was enough is enough. I'm checking out. Not going to lie, I tried going back. And... I guess they were like, no. And I'm grateful for that because had I did go back, had it, you know, manifested again, I guess I'd still be dealing with the same things. I wouldn't have grown and come to realize that some things I shouldn't have dealt with.
Yeah. 2020, you correct me with that, if I'm wrong with the dates. 2020, I'd say... Roundabout is the start of your online popularity.
Yes.
Somewhere there.
Yes.
2020.
Yeah.
Do you wish you could turn back the hands of time and be unfamous?
Not really.
Mm-hmm.
Not really. I always say, and people always say that fame is so hectic. I guess it's not that hectic for me right now because I always look at it as a matter of when people approach me in public, they're appreciating what I do.
Okay.
It's such a great feeling to be appreciated for what you do, especially
affirmed.
And especially if you really
love
enjoy
you
and
do.
Love and passionate about what you do.
Yeah.
It's a great feeling. So I guess fame for me is not that hectic yet. I know it does get hectic. Sometimes you can't even go to the mall and just get your favorite stuff because there's 120 people lining up to see you.
Yeah.
So it's
does,
not.
Does
it's
that
not,
happen to you?
It does, but it's not that hectic.
Yeah.
I think as of yet.
Yeah. It's going to be. You traditional media now, it's coming. There's no turning back after you enter traditional.
But I guess we'll cross that bridge when we get there.
Do you feel like before you started being popular, there was ever a point that you were desperate to be famous?
No. I always knew I was going to be here. I always knew I was going to get to this point. I don't know how, but it's just when you know, you know. I always knew that.
Instinct?
Yes.
Faith.
From a young age, I always knew that this is the
path.
Yeah. I always knew. So all of these things that are happening, they're not taking me by surprise.
I hear you.
But at the same time, it's not making me not appreciate them. I really do appreciate them and I really do take them as they come. But I'm not that surprised that they're happening because I always knew that this is the path I'm meant to take.
So it's not shocking you. It's not making you go crazy. It's not making you be derailed because...
No.
You're just living out the life you've known you're always going to live.
Yes.
Yeah. I get that.
Yeah.
But the source of that, where does it come from? Because there's not many people who have that confidence of understanding at a young age what they'll be and what their purpose is. There are people, Dr. Miles Monroe died mm-hmm. saying that, it's one of his famous quotes, that the richest place on earth is the graveyard, because there's so many dreams that are untapped. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of people who go to their graveyard, who die and are buried mm-hmm. without ever recognizing their purpose.
Yes.
Where do you think the source of recognizing your purpose comes from?
From a young age, you know what? I used to think that there were cameras everywhere, wherever I was, and they're documenting my life. That's why I used to be so dramatic as a kid. And I used to think that when I grow up, I'm going to watch this back as like a reality show of what was happening as I'm growing up. So it's things like that. I always knew like this, I'm going to be doing this. Like at a young age, I used to, you know, Leon Schuster, for example, when he pranks people and then he's like, there's a camera over there.
I hear you.
I used to think that there's always cameras watching me as a kid.
Yeah.
And that's why I used to be so dramatic. And I used to be so theatrical, and I used to be all these things because I knew something. I don't know. It's just, I don't know, maybe God given.
I hear you.
Yeah, God given.
Where's mom and dad when you are expressing yourself, let's say in your early teens, expressing yourself as a creative? Where's mom and dad in this, and are they honing this creativity?
Go to school. Go study something that's...
Study something real. Yeah. That's what they say.
You know what I mean? You can do this on the side. And so I did. I did go to school in UCT, and I studied political science, majored in political science, film, and journalism. I'm done now. I'm about to graduate.
But I'm president. Yes.
So I'm about to put that down and say, okay, you guys wanted this from me. Here's it. And now I'm following my dreams. I guess now that they're seeing a lot of things coming into fruition, I've moved into my own place, and I'm, you know, I'm standing on my own.
Self-sufficient.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I guess they're now just like, okay, you're doing something. And, mm-hmm. and because at the end of the day, I guess that's what parents want.
Sure.
You know? Sometimes it's not a matter of what you do. It's
not a how.
Yeah.
But it's the principles must be maintained. Yeah.
Principles must be maintained. Yeah. And you must be able to take care of yourself.
Yeah.
Because they get to a point where they retire and they don't want to be worrying about you anymore.
Sure.
You know what I mean? So I guess it's that as well. Yeah. So they're comfortable now. And yeah, they're very supportive. Very, very supportive.
Who are you closer to, mom or dad?
I guess my mom.
Yeah, you look like a mama's boy.
Yes. Yeah, my mother. Yeah.
And what type of conversations do you normally have with your mom besides the mundane everyday life conversations? That heart to heart where you have with mom, what do they usually go like?
We usually speak about God.
Yeah?
Yeah. Wow. Speak about God. Speak about...
Is she a prayer mom who sends you the verses then?
She is a prayer mom. We have a family group chat and she's sending the verses. I mean... With announcing the show that's coming up at Queendom, I said to them on the family group chat, and she prayed. She typed a prayer, a whole prayer, and it was, she's that type of mom.
Speaking of Queendom, we'll come back to mom.
Mm-hmm.
When you got that opportunity to audition, take me through the audition.
Yes.
And take me through the moment of when you got the callback that you got the role.
So I was with my... niece.
Yeah.
Yes. I was back in Durban. It was December. And I had to do a self-tape. So I got the email from my agent. Like, okay, they want you audition for this new show, The Queendom on BET. I'm like, okay, let me give it a shot. Now I auditioned, and it was so fun because I was with my niece and we kept laughing. Yeah, it's always a joy with her. And she was so excited. To her, I had already gotten the role.
No.
Yeah, she was very, very excited. And I auditioned. It went quiet for a while. So I even forgot about it. And then come Jan, they're like, you have a callback. I was in Durban at that time, and I hadn't moved here. You have to make it in Joburg. My agent, I'm like...
This Jan.
Yeah, this Jan.
Jeez, and there's already trailers.
Yeah. Fast. So my agent is like, you're going to make it to Johannesburg. I'm like, how? I mean... they need me tomorrow. I'm in Durban. They're like, you're going to make it. And I did make it. I think sometimes with me, I get so nervous and I get too much in my head. And that moment I was like, they need me in Joburg. I need to go for a callback. I need to prepare my transport, everything. Only for me to realize that it's actually possible. Like, I could make it. I didn't have to think about it so much. So when my agent was like, you're going to make it, I had that daunting moment. Like, yes, I actually am. Yeah, it's not that hectic. Yeah. And I made it to the callback, and I went back to Durban that very same day.
Do you think that overthinking stems from a place of being rejected for such big opportunities many times? You almost think, why would this one work out? It's part of you in the corner of your brain is like, why would this work out? Mm. I mean, I've been trying this thing.
Yeah.
Why must I put in so much effort for this one?
For this one, yeah. I think there's an element of that, but also I don't know. Naturally, I'm very impulsive. Because I'm a very nervous person. I thought I was shy, but I'm not shy. I just get really nervous, mm-hmm. and yeah, it gets hectic. But the older I grow, I think the more calm I am now. Yeah.
How many auditions before this have you been rejected for? Don't have to name them.
Yeah. Probably a couple.
Ne?
Probably a couple.
Yeah.
Yeah. A couple.
I ask this because somebody who's watching or listening.
Yeah.
Me too. Yes. Is in their waiting season.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's important that in your waiting season, there are nuggets that you hear from other people who tell you that it will come.
It will come.
It will come.
It will come. I was saying the other day, I'm so grateful. On my Instagram, I was telling the people that follow me, and I'm so grateful because I started this in 2020. And since then, people have been saying, we can't wait to see you on television.
Right.
We pray in God's name, in Jesus' name, you're going to be in television.
Yeah.
And all I kept saying is, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Not knowing that it's actually going to happen. Yeah. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. Throughout those years, it's going to happen. Come 2024, fast forward, and it's happening.
Because sometimes, even when we say it's going to happen, waiting season is not easy.
It's not easy.
Guys, waiting season is hard.
Let's really be honest.
Waiting season, sometimes in the waiting season, things are so bad.
Yes.
All that confidence you had about how great you are, you doubt yourself.
Yes.
Because you see that in the industry, some people are not hired on merit. So you're like, geez, I'm just an ordinary person with no connections. How will I ever get in?
Absolutely.
You know? And that waiting season, that self-doubt mm-hmm. can overwhelm you sometimes.
Yes.
You're so talented, but you're debilitated by all this waiting.
Mm, it is a tough one. But I guess, again, it goes back to when you know, you know.
Yeah.
When you know that, when you can envision the other side of waiting season, it really gives you that faith and hope all the time.
You get the call. Who are you with that you got the role? Obviously, your agent gets the call, right?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm with my niece and my nephew.
No, the niece again.
The niece again and the nephew. And they're super excited. Super, super excited. It was beautiful. Super excited. And my parents were like, okay, you're going to have to move once and for all.
Yeah.
Which you've been saying. And then I did. Yeah.
The funny thing I'm saying the niece again is because remember your niece when you were shooting the self-tape in front of her and you were laughing?
Yeah.
The innocence of a child to have belief. You know, when a child says to mom, mom, I want a PlayStation 5. The child doesn't think of circumstances. The child says, mom, this is what I want and it's going to happen. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That same innocence and that same faith the child has. And for her to be there while you were auditioning and when you get the role is just a representation that in life, sometimes you don't have to overthink things.
Yes.
And when the season has come, it has come.
I guess also that conversation also taps into me as a young kid, having that faith or just knowing that this is where I'm going to
be.
Right?
I
didn't think of so many things. I just knew that this is, and the imagination of thinking that there's constantly cameras watching me everywhere. And having to envision, like, from an innocent place that this is where I'm going to be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody out there is scared to start that TikTok page because it's embarrassing to be acting on TikTok. Or they're just overwhelmed by the feeling that, oh my gosh, I only have 10 followers. How do I get to the point where the Tadeus of this world are, where they're more than 500,000, you know? Why should they start?
Hmm. I think believing in yourself takes a lot. I know it does. Believing in yourself takes a lot, especially if you're an overthinker. But I guess just believing in what you have and believing in what you're God-given in, it's a very important element, because you can never doubt God in anything. It's very, very important. That question also makes me think back. I think when I started out, a friend of mine, she probably even didn't notice, but I told her that I bought a ring light, and she was like, "Ha, what's serious? I said, "What are you doing on TikTok?"
Hectic.
I think at that moment she didn't notice.
Of course, yeah, of course.
She didn't realize that what she was saying. But
then it kind of hurt.
It did.
Because this is you saying, "I'm taking actions towards my dream."
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it didn't bug me so much, because I knew that what my vision was. I knew where I want to take this. So sometimes people don't see it. Other people don't see it, but you see it. And you know how far you want to take yourself. Mm. Yeah.
Why TikTok, though, the particular platform? Because it's 2020. Not many of us know about it in that way. Had you done your research? What made you realize that this thing is the next big thing and being an early entrant is important?
I guess I had TikTok since around about 2018.
Okay.
2017.
I didn't even know about it then.
It was called Musical.ly.
Really?
Yeah, it had a pink, I think, app logo. Yeah, app icon. And people used to lip sync to the trending songs.
Okay.
Yeah, and do transitions and all of these things. So fast forward to around about 2019 or 2020, they changed it to TikTok. And it became more of a content platform in such a way that people were making skits, dance videos. It was no longer just lip syncing to music and transitions. So at that point, I was following a lot of content creators, especially skit makers like Nathan Molefe. For example, I always make an example out of him because I think he's one of my biggest inspirations when it comes to content.
And he's an early entrant as well.
Yes, he was. And I remember I'd come back home. It was 2020. I'd come back home from Cape Town. So Reza was closed, so I was back home for December. And I made a video. And it was at a moment where I felt so creative. Like that season, I felt very creative. Like this overwhelming sensation of creativity. And I made a video and I posted it that night. Next day it was trending. I'm like, okay. Then I made more and more and more and more, and it's been uphill from there.
What was that first video? Do you still remember it?
I do. It was ungabo phela kwamfana. I was saying yes, ungabo phela kwamfana ngoba mo phela kwamfana our last year, some ungafani no sne.
Yeah.
Sne, I got the pair of fana.
It's always sne. It's always sne.
You know what I mean? So I recreated that, and yeah, people really loved it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I want to be practical. So what happens? Do you have content plans? Because maybe somebody thinks TikTok has just become, they blow up overnight.
Yeah.
But people actually put effort into this. They think through this.
Yes.
They put some time and, like, do you have content plans? Do you have, did you teach yourself how to shoot different angles? Because, I mean, you play 7 characters in one video. I'm like, oh my gosh, that's so complicated.
At first, I didn't. Yeah. At first, it was a matter of just going with the wind.
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't at first. But now I do. Because also, it's a matter of growing and elevating what you do.
Sure.
So now my videos are longer. They're a bit more complicated because I have to grow. I can't be making the same things I used to make.
Sure.
You know? So now I do. Now it takes me like, I don't know, an hour or over an hour to make one video, because obviously it's longer and stuff.
An hour is actually short. It means you're really good at, you've mastered it. Because for me, when I look at that 3-minute video where you've got like 4 people and you're acting all of them.
That one, I shot that one in Jan at home. That was like 6 hours.
I can imagine.
6 hours, yeah. 6 hours.
That's insane, bro. That is commitment.
Yeah. So now I'm a bit scared because I know that's what people are going to expect. I don't have 6 hours now, unfortunately. Ish.
Now you're going to be on set almost every day. Are you looking forward to that life?
I am.
Yeah?
I am. I am, but I'm still enjoying it. I guess the OGs are like, ugh, this again. But I'm still in that phase where I'm like, I'm enjoying this.
Yeah.
I remember yesterday on set, people wanted to leave. I'm like, ah, oh, we're leaving. It's lost. Can we carry on? Oh, God, I mean, yeah.
How's the set experience? Are you receiving respect from the OGs?
I am.
Yeah?
I'm being taught a lot. Yeah. I love, especially Samgelo Ndlovu.
Oh, yes. Yeah, yes.
She's the sweetest. Even Linda Mdoba.
Yeah.
All of them are the sweetest, and they're teaching me a lot of the things that I don't know as well. So it's I'm being engulfed beautifully.
Would you say for some of them it's also a proud moment because they know that it's like we've been watching you be great.
Yes,
it's just that nobody has given you the platform.
Yes. Especially Namdowa said it. Like, I think I was with her at the audition.
Okay.
Yeah, and she was like
the callback.
Sorry, the callback, and she was like, "I'm so proud of you that you're actually taking the step. It's been a long time coming."
Yeah. That's so beautiful because there's a perception that people are weird, especially people who are big on traditional media.
Yes.
That they're weird towards people who are digital creators. Mm. And I want to gatekeep the space from them. Mm. So it's nice that Linda Mdoba, Samgelo Ndlovu, is almost being a big sister.
Yes. It's beautiful. Beautiful.
I really hope it continues in that manner.
Mm. Thank you.
I want to go back to, I said I'll come back to your mom. What role does she play to your life over and beyond just being the mom that you can talk to, the mom that prays for you? Is she a mom who understands who you are and has been accepting of who you are?
I mean, yes. Yes. Yeah, I'd like to think so. I'd like to think so. Because I've had various conversations about her, about me, for example, me being queer.
Mm-hmm.
We've had various conversations about it. And she seems a bit understanding.
It's taking time, of course.
Yeah, it is.
It's been a journey.
Yeah, it has been a journey. I think, I don't know where she's at now, but she seems fine. She seems very supportive. I remember this one time we're fighting, I think it was in 2021. We're fighting about the fact I wanted to carry a bag. It was a black bag, just a sling bag, to church. And she was like, "Why do you have a bag? Do you really have to?" I'm like, first of all, what's the issue? The fact that I have a bag. And I explained to her that, no, the fact that I have a bag, if I want to have a bag, I want to have a bag. Whoever says what in church, that's their issue. Because at the end of the day, that means they're in church for the wrong reasons.
Absolutely.
You know? And I gave her that and she was like, okay, I've just been schooled.
Yeah.
So also in that regard, I mean, I've grown to be able to stand up for myself.
Mm.
Yeah, and a lot. Because also being the only child, I've only got me sometimes. So I grew up like that. And so that's how I navigate through life as well.
Yeah. Doesn't only child syndrome, though, make you hyper independent, which is dangerous?
It does.
I'm an only child. I know it. It does. I'm very quick to say, oh, you're doing me dirty? Cool.
Cool.
I've been on my own all along.
You know what I mean? It doesn't trouble me so much. But I always say that even with people, with friends, I don't emotionally connect to friends. So I'm like, okay, is this a flaw or is it to my benefit? Because I understand that people do you dirty.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that, so when people do me dirty, the fact that I didn't emotionally connect to you, it's not going to hurt me if we separate, right? But at the same time, I'm like, I really yearn for that emotional connection with people, with friends. I don't want it to be just reserved for romantic situations. Yeah.
I think you should hone that because nobody has come through for me like friends in my life, especially as a person who doesn't have siblings.
Yeah.
Friends have come through for me in ways that many of my close friends whom I've been friends with for more than 10 years, I've got two specifically in mind. Things that people will never know about, but they've come through for me.
Yeah.
So I hope you do hone relationships like that.
Yeah.
Because they are friends who become siblings.
Yeah.
And even the arguments that we have mm-hmm. will never break the friendship. Yeah. It's like a sibling argument.
Yeah.
It always comes back to the center of the fact that we are siblings.
We're siblings. Yeah. Something I definitely want to work on. I really want that sort of thing. I don't want to be too disconnected to people. Yeah.
Does it not come from a place, though, of just beyond the hyper independence?
Yeah.
The fact that now that you're famous, it's harder to trust people.
I still have the same people around me.
Okay.
Yeah. Even though I understand that it's harder to trust people, but at the same time, I guess this disconnection helps me to be hyper-vigilant of who I have around me.
Yeah.
Like, I can literally see through people. Like
people.
I don't know. Maybe it's a special trait, but I can literally see through someone, whether they're genuine or not. So that's why it's been easy for me to keep the same people that I had been with before I was famous.
Have you ever used your fame to do something wrong, but you got away with it?
No, really. Maybe not yet. Maybe not yet. Let me say that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny because most people don't go to jail because they're famous. They can wiggle their way out of it.
They wiggled away.
Yeah. You speak deeply about your relationship with God. As a queer person,
yes,
many people who are ill-informed, and I'll say that boldly, about a personal relationship with God, they will say that you do not qualify to have a personal relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
And what is your personal relationship with God, and how did you navigate being queer and loving God?
It's funny because studying politics really helped me a lot, especially tapping into how we were as a continent, as Abantu Base Africa, pre-colonial, pre-Christianity sometimes. And we were a nation, we were a people that was very mystical and open to ideas of God. We knew who God was. We all had different perceptions. Also with being queer was believed as a special deity, or you had a special divinity, you were able to master the feminine divine and the masculine. So it was believed to be special beings. Yeah. So knowing that and reading about that a lot really helped me to say and to destigmatize my brain also.
Sure.
Of the
internal homophobia.
Yeah. It really, really helped me.
You're saying that African literature
shows us that
queerness was a divinity not an impediment as how it's been presented for the past 200 years or whatever years.
Definitely was very accepting, I guess, also because having European laws, I mean, Europeans come from a world where it's very segregated and a lot of the things are very stagnant and not accepting. And it's funny now that Europe comes up as a liberal society and an accepting one. And it's thrown all these laws and regulations on African practices to make it seem as if African practices are the ones that aren't
conservative
and unaccepting. Yeah.
But it's actually
the other way around.
Yeah. Your relationship with God right now, where are you?
Oh, I'm so appreciative. I love God so much. I'm always grateful for every single thing. I'm always grateful.
Somebody's watching this and saying God doesn't exist. He's never pulled through for me. I live in pain. I'm in constant poverty. I'm unemployed.
Yeah.
And it's been years I've been unemployed. I struggled to get money to go to school. I've been abused by parents, people who were supposed to love me or a partner. I'm living with diseases that I didn't ask for because of partners. Why should I go back to God, Tadeus?
Phew. That's a deep question. That's a really deep question. Amen. I wouldn't say I have a definite answer for that. But yeah, sometimes things happen.
Mm-hmm.
And in that moment, you may be like, ugh, where's God? Why isn't God coming through for me? Why is this happening to me? Why did God allow it to happen?
Yeah.
I guess sometimes it's all a part of the journey. It's all a part of your journey. It's all a part of your story sometimes, because we all have a story to tell. We all have to grow. As much as that may be a hard pill to swallow, but it is what it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, at times.
What's the most painful thing you've been through? And have you been able to grow from it, as you're saying that every one of us in our story has to grow?
Has to grow. I can't think of the most painful thing I've been through. Yeah. I can't really think of the most painful thing I've been through.
Has to be one.
Has to be one.
There has to be something that's pain and you're like, whoa. Some people, when they're on the chair, they speak of grief over the loss of a loved one.
Mm-hmm.
Some speak of losing themselves.
Yes.
Because the industry took over who they are and they no longer know who they are.
Yes.
Some people speak of being abused.
Yeah.
Growing up. Some people, because of umjolo.
Yeah. I guess it's that one. Also just... I guess feeling alone is also one of the things.
Sure.
I'd say.
You struggle with loneliness quite a bit.
Loneliness. Do I struggle with loneliness? Ish. Maybe. Maybe sometimes I feel like, ish, I'm alone, navigating through life alone. But I guess also that hyper-independence comes through and tells me it's fine.
It's like, whatever.
Yeah, it's fine, whatever. I think failure is one of the... I remember I failed my grade 10. I guess that because I never thought that was something I'd ever go through. So that was a shocker for me. I was really, I would think I was 15, 16.
What subjects were you doing so I can judge you?
You can judge me. I was doing pure maths. I was doing physical science. I was doing, because I went to a school of technology.
Okay.
So it was all the technical subjects.
Did you go to George Campbell?
Yeah.
Okay. Didn't you see my name on that board?
Really?
That was Dax 2012.
Okay.
Yes. I've always been that guy.
Do you get why?
Fully.
Yeah.
George Campbell. Who taught you maths?
Yo, I don't remember.
Who taught me? In grade 10, when things didn't work out. Woodhams, but De Oliveira.
But, yeah.
With that, is he still making people miss a line when writing things?
Yes.
So that old man.
Yes. So you get me.
I get you.
So it was those subjects.
But I don't get you too, because I was like a student through and through.
Okay. I mean, I was a creative. Let me put it that way.
Yeah.
I was a creative.
Definitely as a creative, you were in the wrong school.
Yeah.
You were through and through in the wrong school.
Yeah.
Funny how I'm a creative now.
Yeah.
But I took the longer route. I became an engineer first, became professionally registered, only to start this podcast.
Yeah.
2 years now in March, 2 years ago in March. So I get it.
Yeah.
So, but it's a beautiful journey because you get to learn to think practically.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. You get to learn to think practically. So yeah, I went through that. I was so stressed. I remember when my mom came back with my report, I was so nervous. And we went to the room, we spoke, and she told me I didn't make it. And I was so devastated.
Yeah.
I was so devastated.
And the embarrassment of repeating a grade, oh my goodness. Did you stay in the same school?
No.
Oh, okay.
I changed schools.
Good.
And I remember that night we were having dinner. I think it was the next day we were having dinner. And I was like, I can't do this. I left the food and I went to the bathroom and I started crying. And my mom followed me. And she told me it's okay.
Yeah.
It's fine. And she comforted me in that moment. So, yeah. Also, I guess having to go into a new school now I have to navigate through new people.
Yeah.
And new friends. I didn't want to be there. I was miserable. I think I only started talking to people a year later. I would sit alone during lunch breaks. I wouldn't talk to anyone, interact with anyone. The teachers thought there was something wrong with me. My parents had to be called in school. What's going on? I was really, I really wasn't the best.
Yeah.
That time.
Yeah. But do you see it was birthing the purpose of your creativity?
Yes.
Because you could have been stuck and stifled in a school of technology where it's all about math, science, engineering subjects.
Yes.
But right then at 15, 16, you have no idea that God is birthing your destiny.
No idea.
It feels like disappointment.
Yes.
pain. Like, it's just, you know, only pain, son.
Pain, pain and pain throughout and pain throughout. I guess also we can look into that conversation of when you don't see God in the moment, on the other side, beautiful fruits to bear.
There's beautiful fruits so to bear.
To that person that's feeling like, why should I go back to God?
Sure.
Exactly that.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly because that. A year is a long time to feel like you are just stuck. You're in pain. You're miserable.
Yeah.
So the person, once again, who's consuming this, even if it's been a year, don't count yourself out of your dream.
Yeah, never, never.
Yeah, it still can be done.
Yeah, beautifully so also.
That's crazy, bro, that we went to the same school. But obviously I was gone then because I'm an old hag. Jeez, so you're acting now and then you're moving into music.
Yes.
I just saw this beautiful glimpse that there is another era that you're unleashing.
Yes.
Are we singing? Are we rapping? What are we doing?
We're singing.
Mm-hmm.
We're singing. Yeah, I've always been a singer for as long as I can remember. It's funny, in preschool when they used to sing the national anthem.
Yeah.
I'd be like,
you'll be belting it out.
I'd be ad-libbing. Like, I don't know what y'all doing, but I'm going to add a twist to all of this. And yeah, I've always been a singer. Always.
What are we singing? What's the heart of the music? Because beyond the genre, that's the easy answer.
Yeah.
I want to understand the heart of what forms the lyrics.
What I've been through from being a young teenager, from being a teenager rather, on the outskirts of a teenager to being a young adult, that's love. That's mental health. And through all of that, also choosing to be happy.
Happy. Will that pierce through the music as we listen to it?
Yes.
Like it's a consistent theme.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think people need to hear it through music? Because you're already sharing it through skits, acting. Because even in that, how you write your own scripts, we can see that there's a story telling.
Yeah.
Why do you need to tell it through music now?
So you can take me everywhere you go.
Fair.
So you can take me everywhere you go.
Yeah.
And also, I guess through music, I'm writing my own story. So I guess it's more unfiltered that way.
You can even rewrite the story. Yeah, as well. In a manner that you like.
Yeah, and reinvent it and readapt it and adjust it there. And yeah.
Are you nervous about this new territory? Since you're a nervous person?
I am. I'm just nervous of the reception.
Yeah.
But I love what I did there.
But you're used to criticism, so why does this make you nervous? Naturally, when you're online, people are rude.
People are rude.
Yes.
So rude. But I'll always be nervous, but I'll be fine in the end.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, just as the EP, you'll always go through things, but in the end, you choose to be happy.
Yeah.
And you'll be fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. 5 years from now, it's 2029. Where does Tadeus want to be?
That's a great question. That's a great question. Where I'm meant to be.
Sure.
Yeah, where I'm meant to be.
Yeah.
I'm huge on allowing destiny to take its course. I even tell people that yazi ukuthi masithandaza. When we're praying, we're always siyacela all the time.
Asking all the time.
And I understand. I mean, sonke, we have things that we think we need and things that we want and things that we... Because all of us have something. All of us have goals as well. And we all have something that we want to achieve. But it's important to be grateful. Because once you're grateful, once you change up the prayer and say, ngiyabonga, I'm grateful for this, for that, for where I am, then you allow destiny to take its course and say, now I'm allowing whatever has to come next to come next.
Are you allowing love to find you again?
I don't know if I should or not. I don't know. if I should or I shouldn't.
Yeah.
It's tricky.
It's tricky, right?
It is tricky. Yeah. But I guess I'm not against trying again.
Mm-hmm.
Not against trying again. I definitely would love to. Because
there were good elements of
that. There were good elements.
Yeah, so also, we can't paint it as this bad thing that happened.
Right?
Yeah.
And also, I got an opportunity to learn so much about myself that I didn't know.
Yeah.
Beforehand.
Yeah.
So I guess now I'm also in a better space to navigate what exactly it is that I want and what I want to stand for.
Yeah.
And what, yeah.
One of our favorite moments of the show as we near the end of our conversation.
Yeah.
I always like to ask my guests, what's that one thing in life you know for sure and you're absolutely certain about?
That everything happens for a reason. Certain. There's a reason behind every single thing that happens.
Mm-hmm.
Practically and non-practically.
Okay.
Yeah.
So sometimes you will see the reason. Sometimes you'll see it later.
Sometimes you'll see it later. Sometimes you won't see it. But there's always a reason.
You're content with not seeing the reason as well.
Yes.
But you know it's there.
I know it's there.
So that gives you the faith to keep going.
Yes. Yes. Definitely. Definitely. So, yeah. And just remaining grateful, as I said, like it's part of manifesting, just allowing whatever needs to come next in your life.
Gratitude is a superpower.
Yes.
That always. People don't understand that beyond always asking from a point of desperation, from a point of, oh my gosh, how am I going to survive next?
Yes.
But there is a lot of peace. There is a lot of calmness and stillness that comes with operating from a place of gratitude.
There is. There's a lot.
Yeah.
Way too much. So just let God do God's job.
Tadeus, superstar musician, speaking it into God's ears.
Thank you so much.
Tadeus, superstar actor.
Thank you.
I wish you all the best. Thank you for your time and the privilege of coming to the show.
Thank you.
You have a home here. When you're releasing something else, we're just a phone call away.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Yeah.
And congratulations to all of this. By the way, I'm such a big fan of the show.
No,
I've been watching
come on.
For so
even though our sound was rubbish,
right? I was still there. I was still there.
Because you understand the makings.
I understand the development and the adaptation.
Yeah,
yeah.
I got nothing else to say. I'll see you guys in the next episode.
Introducing the epitome of luxury living, Galu Luxury Villas and Suites, your private sanctuary of opulence and elegance. Nestled amongst the lush, sun-kissed landscapes of Durban, KwaZulu-Natal, this Galu Luxury Villa is a paradise of tranquility, offering breathtaking panoramic views of the neighborhood. Step into a world of refined luxury where every detail has been meticulously crafted to create an atmosphere of sophistication and comfort. This villa is kept within a gated and secure property for your peace of mind. The Galu Villa is available for both short-term and long-term stays, making it the ideal location for your next vacation or special event. This villa boasts spacious living areas and floor-to-ceiling windows that flood the interior with natural light, making you feel at one with the surrounding beauty paired with multiple terraces, an outdoor lounge, and a dining area. Live the dream, make memories, and indulge in the life you deserve. Contact us today to book your stay or to learn more about this exquisite property. Your oasis of opulence awaits.